Hello, everyone. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Welcome to the Brooklyn Rails 566th New Social Environment. I'm Eleanor, the program's assistant here at the Rail, and I have the pleasure and privilege of being your MC today for a conversation featuring Samantha Nye and Ksenia M. Soboleva. And we are thrilled to welcome Dia Felix here to close today's program. Before we get started, the Brooklyn Rail acknowledges Black Lives Matter, and the Brooklyn Rail acknowledges that here in New York, we are on Lenape Hoking, the unceded land and waters of the Wappinger, Canarsie, Munsee, and Lenni Lenape people of the Delaware Nation and the Shinnecock Indian Nation. We encourage you to check the chat for a living document of resources and actions. Today's conversation will be recorded and uploaded to our YouTube channel, where you can also view the full archive of this NSE series. And now to introduce today's guest and host, painter, video and installation artist Samantha Nye lives in Philadelphia. Her work reframes seduction through reenactments of 1960s pop culture. Her paintings, videos, and installations highlight aging bodies, celebrate queer kinship, and facilitate an intergenerational dialogue about sexuality, leisure, and pleasure. Her recent solo show, My Heart's in a Whirl, at the Museum of Fine Arts, Boston, was written about in Bomb Magazine, The Brooklyn Rail, and other publications. And Dr. Ksenia M. Soboleva is a New York-based writer and art historian specializing in queer art and culture. She holds a PhD from the Institute of Fine Arts from NYU with a dissertation entitled Fragments, Art, AIDS, and Lesbian Identity in the United States. Her writings have appeared in the Brooklyn Rail and other publications, as well as various exhibition catalogs. She has curated exhibitions at Candace Mead Gallery, La Mama Gallery, and Assembly Room. Soboleva was the 2020 to 2021 Jan and Maria Vilsack Curatorial Fellow at the Guggenheim Museum, and she is currently an Andrew W. Mellon Postdoctoral Fellow in LGBTQ History at the New York Historical Society. Thank you very much, both of you, for being here. So excited for today, and I'm so excited to pass the mic over to you, Ksenia. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Eleanor, and thank you to the Brooklyn Rail for making this possible. And thank you to Sam for being here and being in conversation with me. Sam, I wore this shirt for you. It is the most colorful item in my wardrobe. And I think it kind of looks like your painting.
Yeah.
It's like Matisse meets Samantha and I. I think we can start the slideshow now, maybe. Great. So we can just dive right in. And Sam, you and I have known each other for a while. It all started with a studio visit a few years ago when I traveled to Yonkers. Do you remember that?
Oh, and by traveling, yes, you sure did. Yeah, it was like a 2-hour journey for you to get there.
And I remember instantly falling in love with your work, which I had already been following, but I hadn't really seen in person except at the Yossi Milo show. And then the thing that I remember most about that studio visit is that at some point, I don't know if you remember this, you handed me a small dog, a live dog, like an actual dog.
Oh, right. Yeah, yeah.
And I was holding it, and it's probably the tiniest dog I've ever seen. And I was holding it, and then it pooped.
It
fell out.
I'm so happy this is what you remember from the studio visit.
That is what I remember.
Wow, I'm honored.
How do you remember it?
I don't even remember. I know the dog. I was dog sitting. I did not remember the dog was there. I just remember really having such a lovely time and feeling like I met someone who really saw the work and also me. And I felt like, wow, I want to be friends with Ksenia and I need to learn how to say her name, which took me probably 3 or 4 months. But no, I feel like I immediately left feeling like we'd known each other or we were meant to meet.
I feel the same way.
Yeah.
And I am so, so excited that you have this incredible show. It's your first solo show in New York at Candace Mady Gallery. And it's a series of 7 new paintings. And I know that a lot of people had no idea that you were a painter, because your previous solo show at the MFA in Boston was a video installation. Mm-hmm. And many know you through your video and film practice. And so now you've sort of come out as a painter when actually you started as a painter. And
yeah, I mean, I think of myself as a painter completely and like a part-time video artist. But yeah, it's interesting that I feel like I've kind of been a little bit more like forward with the video practice.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it does feel funny that I'm like having to come out as a painter when that's like my everyday.
Yeah. So could you walk us through your journey as a painter? When did you start? How did it begin?
Yeah, I mean, I had the type of childhood that a lot of artists talk about having, which is just that like I could render things, and I was applauded and congratulated for that. So I always was a person who was really interested in drawing and painting, but I had never formally painted and never formally touched like oil paint until actually pretty late, considering a lot of artists start in high school. I didn't go to college right away. I became a massage therapist. And so I didn't actually go to community college to learn to paint until I was like 24, 25. So that's when I started oil painting. And it was sort of like some kind of missing piece was connected. I mean, I really like very clearly remember the moment that I learned how to like mix paint and was like, oh shit, this is that thing I've been meaning to do my whole life. And I was always a figurative painter from that moment, not a good figurative painter, but I was a figurative painter from the moment I started. And I think a lot of that had to do with this long history of being a massage therapist. It's at that point, I had been a massage therapist since I was 17. And so the body anatomy, like thinking about what the body holds, like all of those things were really like pivotal to the way I thought. So figurative painting was like an immediate.
Yeah. And then did you go straight to grad school after your undergrad?
Well, I went to community college where I actually had like a really amazing experience. I was mentored by this painter, this professor of mine. And then from there, I went to like an official undergrad at the Museum School in Boston. And then, no, I did not go straight to grad school. I was always told to take a break. And I was really grateful for that break. And that break was amazing because it also included like beyond just like the real life need to learn to be a painter in a world where you also have to work and be like very focused on like real life stuff. It also included caretaking for elders in my family and time being a caretaker for a woman with Alzheimer's and being like a really close companion caretaker for her. And so it furthered what I would be doing with my work, which I was already always working with older women, aging bodies in my work. But by the time I had all of that experience, entering grad school was really helpful for me.
Mm-hmm. So this series of paintings up now, the starting point is Slim Aarons and his poolside photographs. Where did that interest begin? What attracted you to Slim Aarons in particular?
You know, it kind of goes a little bit before that series was started. I was painting mostly women in my family or like extended family in Playboy scenes. And so from there, I would do like a full photo shoot and a set, you know, depending on what scene they chose. So we would sometimes have like a big studio filled with hay for like a hay barnyard scene. And I always wanted to do a scene with all of the women together, because in life, I was spending time with them as a group. These were my grandmother's friends. They all lived in the same building. They go to the pool at the same time. And I really wanted to do a scene of them all in the Playboy grotto, the Playboy pool that's like a cave. Mm-hmm. But for some reason, I never found the perfect Playboy pool picture. Like I just never, I don't know. I wasn't drawn to the photos that I saw. And coming back to like the ultimate pool photo, I mean, you can't escape that Slim Aarons is that, you know, that bitch. So my partner actually gave me a beautiful Slim Aarons photography book And it reminded me how this imagery was kind of also, like, I grew up in South Florida, you know, leisure pool images are kind of what South Florida is really made of. And so these Slim Aaron's photos were really a part of this aspirational part of, like, culture down there, right? Like, everyone kind of longs to be in those places. So when I had that book, it was, like, pretty clear that the women needed to be in those spaces.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we actually have some images that show your work side by side, the Slim Aaron's.
Oh yeah.
Graphs. Can we go to those, Eleanor? Yes, and we'll be able to see that. Yeah, so the Slim Aaron's photographs tend to be not as populated as your paintings, and obviously his very heteronormative idea of what attractive people. Oh, actually, should we address the exhibition title? So the exhibition title is,
sure, yes,
people doing attractive things in attractive places. And it originates from a quote that Slim Aaron's once referenced his work as photographing attractive people, mm-hmm, doing attractive things in attractive places. Which is a wonderful, I love a good alliteration. But of course his idea of attraction was extremely heteronormative, white, and privileged.
Absolutely.
And so you are queering Slim Aaron's, and you have, you have a real investment in the elderly queer community and the elderly community at large and the queer community at large. And I mean, those two together is just great. You already mentioned how that, you know, is rooted in your caregiving and your own family. And I think that something that for some people your work could be easily, I guess, misunderstood as making fun of, you know, like, aging bodies or tapping. There's this whole thing within art history where, you know, you tap into the abject by representing an aging body, just really problematic, right? And so how do you navigate that? Because that's not at all what you're doing. You know, there are other things, we've talked about this, that there are other things in your work that are funny, but it's actually not.
Right, it's not the aging body. I mean, to be honest with you, I haven't come up against anyone thinking that I was making fun of aging bodies, but I have entered a room or a critique or a conversation where immediately the laughing does seem to be immediately because it's an aging body doing this action and not because the painting. I do think my paintings are funny, but I think they're funny because they're kind of poking at art historical references, like particularly the one we're looking at now. Is there a way you could see this painting just as its whole?
Yeah, I know. Can we go to another slide?
Maybe.
It's just like one side reference.
There we go. Yeah, 12.
Yeah.
So in this painting, I mean, it's, to me, it's funny that there are people peeing in a pool in the same way that you would have an opulent pool setting with fountains, like, lusciously pouring water into the pool. Yeah. I'm thinking a lot about, in this case, like, and you would know this reference better than me, but like the peeing, what is it called? Like the little pissing man, the in Brussels, the fountain.
I think
it's a little pissing man. I don't know. Yeah,
but also Bruce Nauman. I mean, for me, what's funny, all these historical reference, Bruce Nauman, Duchamp, the pissing man.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. So for me, that's really funny. And I think there's a lot of funny things about it, but I don't think that the humor is rooted in, like, oh, there's a grandma showing tits, you know? And a lot of people will send me references on the internet of older women kind of doing outlandish things. And sometimes I'm really into it. And sometimes I do feel like, ooh, this feels like that thing. This feels like maybe, I don't know if she's in on the joke, and that doesn't feel good to me.
Exactly. So how do you navigate that?
Well, I'm just, as you see here, you know, I'm not super concerned with the conversation around whether I'm making fun of older women has never crossed my mind, really. So I don't feel like I'm navigating that, but I do feel like I'm making, you know, I'm the humor that I'm investing in the painting is like just kind of innate and has to feel really good to me. The thing that I'm also navigating, and this is probably the best way for me to answer this, is a lot of these images come from porn. And there are a lot of older women, and it's like in the category of like granny porn. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I spend a lot of time searching for images, and I find a lot of images, but about 60% of them are unusable because of the way that older bodies are treated in porn. And, you know, older women of color, like the way that people are treated in porn, not surprising to any of you, sometimes is actually really not okay to me. And so especially these aging bodies. And so I have to find, like, my navigation of that is like finding the ones that feel like there's actually pleasure to be had, and not just like, this is funny.
Yeah. And I would love to talk about that process more. So I know that you source a lot of these from porn, and then do you ever have people pose for you?
So the answer is mostly no for posing. I do try to sneak my grandmother into as many paintings as I can, and often twice. Like in this painting that's up right now, Pool Party One, this is the first painting of the series I made, and my grandmother's in here twice. She's in the center in that circle of everyone sitting around. She's kind of stacked on many pillows. Yeah. And she's also on the right-hand side with her butt facing us. These are photos I've taken of her when she was alive. I'm really happy that in undergrad, I wasn't making great work in undergrad, but I was already working with my grandmother, her friends, my mother. And so like, I happened to have a lot of photographs, and my grandmother was really open to being in like the wildest work. I mean, even wilder things than I do now, she did. And so I keep pulling from those. So in that case, I've posed my mother and my grandmother for projects when I was like young, and still gleaning from those now. But other than that, no, I don't pose anyone else. It doesn't mean I don't know other people though. Sometimes I might know them, and I might pull a photo from like a day at the beach or their backyard pool.
Or have Emily do a certain pose.
Well, my partner's never... She's not old enough to be invited to the party, but she does sometimes have to, like, you know, if like the foot is like half there and I need like the heel or the knee or something, she'll kind of come in for that.
Yeah, a foot model.
Yeah, she's a hand model.
Okay, so you don't have to give away all your secrets, but where does the painting start?
The painting starts from the Slimerans reference. Mm-hmm. And there's different things I'm attracted to in the Slimerans reference. Sometimes I'm really attracted to what I can do with the symmetry of the space or the landscaping. You know, sometimes there's this really like genital-like landscaping decisions that they've made. Okay, not to be a stickler, but I do want to say that this is a different paint. Like this painting is a different reference from this. So maybe if you want to find the painting called, now I've forgotten what it's called. 1-800 Flowers, I think is what it's called. Let me see. It's 11, number 11. There you go. Yeah. So in this one, this is a great one to pull up for this. In this case, I was really interested in the way it's like almost symmetrical, but kind of gives you two spaces to imagine inhabiting that we don't get to see. And I love that. I love holding back from the viewer. Like this is the sort of pleasure zone that you get to see in front of you, but like what's happening in the back? But also in this one, I was really excited about what it means to replace the architecture as well. So, and this is sort of maybe a different question than you're asking, but I think it is kind of where this one started.
It's something I want to talk about.
Yeah, I think that I'm really interested in these spaces because they represent pleasure, they represent leisure, they represent a kind of opulence that we strive for. And this has not changed. I mean, on Instagram, people are just like paying, you know, ungodly amounts of money to go spend 20 minutes in like a fake jet so they can seem luxurious. So like we still as a culture really care about this, but I also like personally am not like super invested in this kind of like everyone's rich, like a fantasy where everyone has a mansion. I'm more interested in what it means that like this could generate wealth or this could be what's happening behind the like Palm Beach mansion, but also kind of playing with what the ideas are of this opulence. So the building in the back, if you can remember, and I'm sure we'll go back to the original Slimerans reference, is like a pretty sprawling mansion. In this case, I found a cabin that I made less cabiny, but I found the structure of this is from a cabin that was in like lesbian connection from the, I think the 80s, early 80s. So this was kind of a secret cabin that they were advertising, you know, only in queer spaces at a time where there was no internet to bring people in. And this was for like lesbians to come and have a safe place to be. And I think it probably only slept like two or three people. But enlarged to the scale, it sort of tricks you and makes you think that maybe this is that mansion, but in fact, it's not. Mm-hmm. And then because of that, I thought a lot about formally how to make it work, which is why I turned it not into a cabin, but also this idea of it growing over, like this kind of like sweet reference to something that's no longer, I wanted it to be overgrown, but in a way that was also kind of lovely and maybe still possible to inhabit. In this one, I just want to say my grandmother's on the balcony, kind of like, I don't know, Mardi Gras, like boob hanging over the balcony thing. You can't see her. She's really tiny in this picture, but.
In the one in the back. Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. She's one of the ones in the back. So, so to go back to the original question, I start with the slim errands and I see what the slim errands needs to be like the attractive thing to me. Like what can they be doing? So do I want like orgies in the foreground? Do I want, you know, like in this one, I really love that there's like this like really peaceful yoga scene in the far left, like all the way back in the deep space. But then there's these like little sections of sex or sensuality happening. And then like some people just having tea. Also, I think I don't know if it's important to the viewer, but it's important to me that a lot of these people that I put together aren't actually found together.
Yeah.
So some of them are. But a lot of them are not. And so the impossibility of this location being inhabited in this way is something I'm really excited about.
Yes.
And I try to clue the viewer into that.
Yeah.
What were you saying, Ksenia? I'm sorry.
I was going to say it's also so utopian. I mean, like for many of us, it took a while, if ever, to discover places that are so populated by other queer people.
I mean, and now I can only think of a few, like Reese Beach.
Yeah.
Obviously clubs, gay bars, but especially outdoor spaces, you know.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I've never been in this type of space.
I have not either.
I rarely find myself by a pool to begin with. I would love to do that more, but unfortunately. But also your titles are just fantastic. How do you arrive at your titles? Like why 1-800 flowers?
Okay, so you know it's funny because I think 1-800 flowers would almost make more sense in a painting that had a lot of flowers. But I don't remember if I sent you this detail, but there's a detail to the right. There's a woman with her knee on a orange pillow, and she has a flower coming out of her butt.
Oh yeah.
And for me, I just thought of her as like the flower delivery guy. And I was laughing one day. I think I posted that as a detail on Instagram one time and just said, call 1-800 flowers. And it just became, that's like, for me, where that moment came, where I was like, this has to be the title for this painting. And then the titles come in other places. There's a painting called, Making Fruit Punch.
Yes, I love that.
I don't know if we could go to that. I could tell you the number. It's number 9. So actually, I saw earlier that my lifelong best friend is on this call. Hi, Simone. And I was showing, I can't remember, Simone, sorry if it was you or your partner, Courtney. I was showing maybe both of them these paintings when it was first being made in the studio, like barely anything was here, but I did have that big ball, the dildo ball. And I think I had maybe the woman kind of sketched in. And they have, Courtney and Simone have 3 children, and their oldest just kind of glanced at it and said, is she making fruit punch? And I was like, yeah, she's making fruit punch. So that's where that title came from. But, you know, a lot of like deep les, like nods to like lesbian culture. Like I have a painting called Constant Craving, which I think we all know, the Katie Lang song. And for me, that came from, that is number 10. For me, that came from the way that if you look to the right, everything sort of has a stillness to it, but to the right, there's like movement in that one tree. And I felt like that tree had a lot of personality, and it just started to me feeling like it was singing Constant Craving or kind of swaying to the Katie Lang rhythm. So that's where a lot of those come from.
I love it. And can we go to thirsty? That's
sure.
Let's see, that's number it's down 16.
Can you say it like it's such a question? Let me hear the intro. Thirsty?
Yeah. So there is some soda from what, the 70s, the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted to talk about this painting a little bit because actually it kind of stands out
mm-hmm.
from all the other ones because there actually is only a little bit of pool visible.
Right, just a little sliver.
At first, I was even like, oh my God, she did a painting where there actually is no pool.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
And then
this is groundbreaking.
Oh no. A shift in her practice. There actually is a little bit of pool on the right.
A little bit of pool, yeah.
But how did you, I would love to know when in the process of these seven paintings where this one came and essentially what made you decide to focus on like kind of a tiny area.
Yeah,
it really does stand out. It's very distinct from
you. Yeah. Well, again, I come back to the reference. And so I have my Slim Aaron's books are a total disaster because I have lots of notes and, you know, I should probably get new copies that are like pristine and then my studio copies. So I have many ones that I know I will work on someday. And this one just stood out to me as something I really wanted to do as a way to kind of create a more intimate look, an interior look. I mean, this is like a very like, feels very comfortable to me, like Floridian, that space that's like indoor outdoor space where you can really be like in between the two worlds. But the shadow was really alluring to me in this reference. And also there was such a stillness, such a quietness. And I was like really, really interested in just having just a few women in the space. Again, I'm always thinking about what might be happening, like, you know, if you cross the threshold of that door to the left or go into the pool to the right, like what's happening there. But whatever's happening there, there's a stillness happening here. And I was really interested in that. I also just thought like this bar, this like, you know, sort of this bar that provided like soda and alcohol was like just such a kind of funny, like, centerpiece because nobody's drinking anything in the Slim Aaron's. I mean, there's some cups there, but even in the Slim Aaron's, there's nobody like engaging with that bar. So I was really, really taken by that. And the first image that I found was the woman fingering herself. And as soon as I put that in there, I was like, got it. Like this makes sense. And then to go back to your question about the name, I was doing some research about what orange soda advertisements were in that time. So this was the like Orange Crush advertisement. Like it was just thirsty. So yeah, that's where that title comes from.
So how much research?
Is kind of a thirst trap, I think.
Yes, I do. I figured. How much research do you end up doing when, you know, because so much of the Slim Aaron's photographs is problematic, like I imagine, and in fact I know that you do a lot of research around, you know, what everything references and the history of it, have you ever decided not to pursue a certain photograph because it was just
because I mean, there was a photograph I was really visually drawn to, and then I looked into where it came from, and it was like at one time a plantation, and I was not willing to take that into the work. I don't feel prepared to like repopulate that space.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's actually a little bit, the information that I have on Slim Aaron's, like where each location is just simply like a caption. And so sometimes I actually can't find any more information about those spaces, and sometimes I can. So I do as much research as I can on that. And then, yeah, make a decision based off of, I mean, it's always a visual decision first, what I can do with the space. And then sometimes, sadly, I just find I can't do anything with the space.
And have you ever visited one of the original spaces?
Wow, what a good question. I haven't. I haven't, but I did find.
We should go on a tour.
Oh, I would love that. I know in Palm Beach, I'm sure there's many, but I did find recently there's the most popular Slim Aaron's image I've never done. It's a pool. There's like famously like, I think yellow loungers and a woman in a white crop top and pants. Anyway, I recently found something about how that house had was up on the market and the Zillow link to it. And I thought, oh, I'm sure that was from a few years ago and I'm too late, but I would have really loved to tour that
house. Yeah. And you, other than changing the architecture, you often sneak in an art historical reference. And this is where we actually could go to that last image that has the thing centered. Yes, so there's this, and there's also your painting that's in the collection of the MFA Boston has an Antruid sculpture at the center. And then here it's an Anne
Elizabeth Catlett.
Elizabeth Catlett. So, I mean, it's pretty, you know, I can see how you went there. but with the Antruid, for example, it's actually more of a it's a farther fetch. How do you have certain artists in mind that you know at some point you like to insert into your works? Or
I mean, I'm really interested because a lot of these spaces especially because of the kind of wealth that these spaces represent, you know, they have these big sculptures, and so I either want to take the sculptures out completely or replace them with a sculpture made by a woman and a queer woman. Would be amazing. I'm really interested in paintings that were made or sculptures that were really kind of maybe being made at the same time. That's not a definite for me. That doesn't matter to me. Like I could put a more contemporary or even art historical reference, but I do find an interest where they kind of might overlap. So this is called Torsos. It's from the 80s. So it is a little bit later than this picture, which I think was probably in the early 70s. But this is such a beautiful sculpture and made by an artist who was so important, you know, a woman of color making sculptures in the 70s and 80s, and really beautiful, like big sculptures based on identity and body. And so I just thought, like, well, how amazing would it be if I took the figurative painting out and put a kink scene in instead? And then let that platform be for, you know, people who are experiencing pleasure, and then keep the figurative sculpture to the front.
Yeah. And in terms of art history, and we could go to another painting now, but I also would love to hear you talk about who you were informed by when you were studying painting, but also how that has changed over time and who you're informed by today. Or
yeah, I mean, there's kind of like a jumble of things. I feel like I went to school in undergrad in a place that was like really buzzing with contemporary artists and conversation around contemporary artists. And I bring that up because now that I'm a professor, I realize there are places where schools are not buzzing around contemporary art. I didn't realize that wasn't just like what undergrad experience was. And so I had really amazing queer professors at that time, which I feel really lucky about. So Laurel Sparks, nod to Laurel Sparks, who was an amazing professor of mine. And so, you know, she introduced me to like Monica Majuli, and I don't know if I'm saying that name right, but I think I am.
Yeah.
And so like, you know, obviously Hockney, I mean, you can't avoid the Hockney references. I wouldn't want to avoid the Hockney references, but those are pretty major. But at the same time, I went to a school that was connected to the Museum of Fine Arts Boston. And so, you know, there's so much there in art history that was like extremely important to me. So I mean, I feel like there was like, I had like both this like sort of museum, institutional museum context, as well as like really exciting. And I feel like at the time I was in undergrad in Boston, it was like very, the focus was really on like performative, like feminist performance. So I was thinking a lot at that time around like Patty Chang, and you know, I was making, you know, with my grandmother and my mother, like Joan Jonas nods and lots of those kinds of references as well.
Yeah. I mean, it's you know, I have written before that there is a real renaissance of queer figurative painting lately. Yes. So this is the perfect time for your solo show, but that has not always been the case. And actually your commitment over the last, you know, 15 years, mm-hmm. Not to give away your age, is
no one knows.
It is just so, you know, admirable and wonderful. But I was actually fishing for another artist.
I know exactly what you're talking about, and I'll let you bring that up. But I have to say, like, that is not a huge reference for me. But why don't you go ahead? Because I know exactly.
That's where you started. Okay. Sam has told me.
Oh, I thought you were going to talk about something else. Okay, you continue. Let me hear what you're going to say.
Okay. You told me that the idea for this painting series kind of started in Ragonar.
Yes. You're right. Sorry. We started this question off with what I was looking at a younger age. So I'll say I wasn't Dragon Art at a younger age, more like mannerism, like Pontormo, like things like that. I was really in Titian, like I was really interested in that. And Bosch, like I think that's part of this.
Yes. Well, for sure. And I call you, what do I call you?
Well, that's what I thought you were about to say.
So that's why I know that's not a reference for you, but I just like
calling. Well, I want to hear I would love to hear your thoughts on that and share that with our amazing viewers. But for me, okay, when I first came to New York, I had this job as this caretaker for this woman with Alzheimer's. And initially the job was simply for me to be like an art caretaker, which meant I would take her to things that she was once very capable and excited and a part of in culture in New York. And then it turned into me being like her closest confidant kind of caretaker. But for a while we would go to the Frick. She lived right by the Frick. So we would go like often. And I spent a lot of time in the Fragonard room, and I started thinking about, I think those paintings are called like the process of love, and each painting then has its own title. And that's also where I still sort of title these like attractive people and attractive places, or doing attractive things in attractive places / constant craving. And I really love that that was the constant in those Fragonard pieces. I don't consider my work to visually look like Fragonard. I understand that the strokes and the colors are so different, but if you've spent time in the Fragonard room, you understand the way that the scale like just kind of overtakes you, and also this commitment to storytelling piece by piece. And I'm not here linear storytelling, but I was interested in that. And so, yeah, that's a huge reference for me in here that I think is buried and maybe unseen. But you always refer to me as, I will let you give the title. But for me, I've always been like, I need to look into that more. So I don't have as much of a connection. But anyway, you can.
The reason is not that profound. It's when we first met, I started referring to Sam as the lesbian Bruegel. Just because, you know, I grew up in the Netherlands, so I've seen a lot of Bruegel, and there was something about these paintings that reminded me of 16th century Dutch genre painting, where, you know, you have to, like, as your eye travels across the painting, you discover all these naughty details of somebody peeing in the bushes and people having sex, and I don't know, and it just came to me. I was like, you're the lesbian Bruegel.
I mean, I love it. I just feel like slightly embarrassed that I don't like identify as much as I should with that. But I think the more I've looked
into it. I don't think you should. No, I think Fragonard or really any reference would probably be.
But I appreciate it. And I feel like I'm going back in my art historical lessons and learning more about that.
Yes, and Bosch. Yeah, Bosch.
Bosch.
But also Fragonard, it's just so gay, you know?
Right, so gay.
Like, so gay. I don't know how you can be in that room and not, you know, just feel it's gay.
Very I feel very dandy in that
room. Yeah. I think that maybe this is a good point to talk about your video and film for a little bit. Because I'm sure that we have viewers who did just discover your work through the show of paintings and who are in fact not familiar
with it. You mean I'm finally just a painter to some people?
Exactly. So now let's have a coming out moment where you're all coming out as, ta-da, I also make video.
Make video installation, yes.
Which is also queering. another mid-century reference. So mm-hmm. let's play, what we're gonna do. So basically Sam's film practice revolves around the art of the scopatone, which is the precursor to today's music video from the 60s. And what Sam does is she takes these scopatone videos and then she queers them and makes her own versions. So we're gonna first play an earlier piece. We're gonna play the original scopatone first, then Sam's, and then we're gonna play a later piece, first the scopatone and then Sam's. So enjoy.
I love my calendar girl.
So fun. I love that these were in dance clubs. Okay. The recordings are available.
Yeah, I'll post the links. Do you want to go to the next set or
yeah, let's do all the viewings then.
Okay.
Hey, Daddy. I want a diamond ring, bracelets, everything. Daddy, you better get the best for me. Daddy, but I look swell in sables, clothes with parrot labels. Daddy, you better get the best for me. I want a brand new car, champagne. caviar. Daddy, you ought to get the best of me.
Important to note as we watch Sam's version is that the main protagonist is your mom, mm-hmm. which we'll talk about.
Hey, Daddy, I want a diamond ring, bracelets, everything. Daddy, you ought to get the best for me.
So many things to say. So good. Let's pull up the slide where we actually see film stills with their original Scopitone reference. I mean, I look at these and I'm like, oh, this is so brilliant. And then I look at your paintings and I'm like, no, wait, this is so brilliant. And it's, you know, I think that you are just so brilliant.
Oh,
and
thank you.
It's such an honor to be your friend, truly.
Thank you.
And to see your work develop and to get to witness it, truly. I don't even know where I want to start. I want to talk about your mom, but I also want to say that something that I really love about this is that, you know, for example, for Daddy, these aren't just actors playing daddies. You actually had a process of casting daddies.
Yes.
Can you talk about that?
Sure. Yeah. So I found different ways in New York to kind of put a casting out. The lesbian sex mafia, which is this like kink, and often for lesbians of all ages, but a lot of the like core sort of organizers are you know, older, maybe like in their 50s and above. So I put out some calls there, different like lesbian sex clubs, like underground kind of parties, and just said I was interested in meeting folks that consider themselves queer lesbian daddies over the age of like 60. And I got such an amazing response. And so I didn't know what to do with the response. So I wanted to cast everybody, but I had everyone come in and perform like a monologue about why they were drawn to this title, and I had the sculpture, the St. Andrew's cross, the double cross, I had that like partially made, and so kind of performed with that a little bit, and then basically just like said yes to everyone, and then it ended up being whoever was available kind of filled in like the daddy that they wanted to be, and we would talk about what that means. Like, for instance, on the right, you know, I was like, I'm thinking about making a tinseled sex swing. What interests that about you? And she was like, the feeling of the tinsel, like the, not tinsel, tassels, fringe. The feeling of the fringe, like the feeling of that, like, and so I was like, okay, great. how do we feel about fringe shoes just kind of sweeping across your face? Okay, great, let's do that, you know? Okay, so you're into spanking, let's figure that scene out. And so the idea with this, and I know you wanted to talk about my mom, the idea with this is that like my mom, in my head, doesn't mean you're getting it as an audience, but like the way that I make something is I have to kind of have like a firm narrative for myself. So like for me, the idea is like mom is looking for her daddy, but how could she find her daddy? Well, she has to audition them based on how well they perform kink on their daughter, on her daughter. So the idea is that like in the original version, Julie London is performing to the audience with, you know, these like luscious sort of strippers behind her. Initially, I was looking for strippers. There's this beautiful strip club in Atlanta called the Claremont, where a lot of the strippers are like over the age of 60. And so originally I was going in that direction, but the daddy part just kept bringing to me. And I was like, nope, this one has to be daddy's. So that's how that started. And you can see the reference is pretty clear to the original set. But then the actions, you know, like you'll see there's like a chair. So let's bring a chair there and make that into like the spanking chair. There's no swing in the original, but.
Mm-hmm. And when did you first start working with your mom and what is that process like?
Wow. So I started working with my mom in undergrad. I mean, and my grandmother. I mean, I made, these are not good, but basically every painting I made from undergrad on were with my mother. You actually haven't seen all of them. I mean,
on your website really early on.
Remember? Well, accidentally, I didn't, I'm like,
I know.
So when you told me that, I was like, impossible. But actually, I'm going even further from that. That was never on. So embarrassingly, for a while, these hot tub paintings, which I, by the way, I love them. I feel really tender towards them, but I wouldn't want to show them.
Yeah.
I made paintings with my mother and I in a hot tub, but I made these paintings with my grandmother and my mother and I, kind of like naked and taped to each other. I mean, very undergrad shit, right? Like pulling the tape off, you know, like whatever. It's very, you can imagine it. Mm-hmm. But from there, I was thinking of them not in this direction at all, but from there to read kept being that there was like this kind of like sexuality to them. And I was really interested in that because I was also very much like reading queer theory at the time, thinking about psychoanalysis and Freud. And I got really interested in that, as often we do when we're younger, and also still so much to mine from now, but like that's where it started. I made this video that was kind of referencing mirror check, Joan Jonas mirror check, where I was like faux masturbating with a double-sided mirror, and the other side of the mirror was my grandmother and my mother sitting there watching me, and you only knew they were there based off of like how the other side of the mirror. And it's so funny, my grandmother fully fell asleep. It was like a two-hour performance and my grandma just like fell asleep. So there's these amazing moments where you're seeing like her breasts or her vagina, but then you're also seeing her face and she's kind of like, what, you know, like bored. And that's what's so funny to me, because like what I'm doing now is so much tamer than what my young undergrad self was doing, that again, I'm just so happy I was doing that because I have these images of my grandmother. But so I started working with them really early on. You asked me what the process is like. My mother's wonderful. She encouraged me to be an artist from a really young age. She doesn't love doing this, but she is happy to do it. And mostly she's just kind of shy. So being the lead of a video was never in her, like it was never her aspiration, but she did really clearly want me to be a child model. So there's a part of her, like, I know that trying to get me to be a child model was also trying to pay the bills, which didn't work out. Like I wasn't successful, but I don't know how much she was like working her own like thing out, but like, obviously she pushed me in that direction, so she must not be super afraid of the camera, but she doesn't love performing, but she does it, and I'm grateful for that.
And I think also that you can see a bit of discomfort, and I think that yeah. adds to the work. Yeah. But a big part of why you are so attracted to these mid-century references, right, and queering mid-century references like the Scopatone, like Slim Aaron's photographs, is because that was sort of the sexual prime of your mother yeah. and your grandmother, right?
Yeah.
Growing up around that, what was that like?
Well, my mother and my grandmother were both highly like, I don't want to say, yeah, they were kind of like sex crazed for the way that you could admit to being that, you know, in their time. So my grandmother married multiple times, you know, you could only have sex once you were married. And so this is, I think, how she explored that. And then when she was like, once her last husband, who was my grandfather, passed away, she dated a lot, and her friends dated a lot. And they would sometimes like have a boyfriend for a few years, and then the other one would have the same boyfriend. And it was never kind of competitive. I mean, it was a little competitive in like fun ways, like the building would host a dance and they'd say like, oh, he didn't ask me to dance. He asked you to dance. And I was hoping to dance with him, but you know, they weren't mad if someone dated, they both dated Peter, you know? And so I was really around their sexuality, their performance of sexuality, their desire to be seen as, you know, attractive people doing attractive things. And I am so grateful for that, because that's really missing in culture. So I really got to see it. You know, I think, again, my long-term best friends on this is viewing this. And, you know, I think of anyone that I know, she would know the most of what I mean when I say, like, my grandmother was very interested in being like social, partying, kind of being out there with like the cute men. And so, yeah, that's, I think I got a lot of that from them. And simultaneously was like very, very, very like, I think a lot of queer people might identify with this. It's either like, you know, you're queer at a young age, or in my case, you're like, sexuality does not exist. I don't understand what you're talking about. I am completely devoid of sexual impulse. So my mother and grandmother were like, what is up with you? We don't understand what's going on here. And then finally, we figured it out.
Yeah, that was gonna be my next question. What is queer? Because, you know, now you're this, I don't know if I'm allowed to reference your high school photographs. That I've seen. Sam was very butch back in the day.
Yeah, not so much in high school, but after, as soon as I came out, I got into this. I sort of like mirrored what I thought was hot, you know? Like,
yeah.
So I
had a butch face.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I'm so femme.
Yeah, I was just gonna say. I don't know. I really appreciate the kind of like gender journey I had as a younger person. But it is, you know, I feel so utterly at home in my femme identity that it's kind of sweet and funny to look back. But yeah, I modeled what I wanted to sleep with. And that's what I wanted to look like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then the other great thing about these is that you commission queer musicians to work with the soundtrack. So I think Calendar Girl is J.D. Sampson, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this is Justin Vivian Bond.
Yep.
And what is that experience like of working with queer musicians?
Well, it's great. I mean, the first one I did was Calendar Girl. Maybe we should pull up a Calendar Girl.
Yeah.
There we go. Okay, so this is Calendar Girl mixed with Silencer, but, oh, no, I see, Calendar Girl, sorry, I was looking at it wrong. So actually, this is great, we didn't show you Silencer. So Silencer, I commissioned Steph Taylor, who's a queer musician in Miami and in a band called The State Of. So when I reached out to J.D. Sampson, I at that point was not with my current partner, and so I didn't have a musical language, so I kind of was like, hey, J.D., I think you'd be great for this particular song. It makes sense to me. And I think I was like, I want it glittery, you know, like a visual reference that makes no sense to someone with like musical knowledge. But clearly, like, JD came through. I thought the song was amazing. I had like zero notes. Like, it was just perfect. But since then, the other two that I made while I was partnered and with my current partner, Emily Wells, who's a musician. And so she's been really helpful because she actually made the music for Daddy and Justin Vivian Bond sang. But also Emily has helped me understand how to speak to musicians. So that's been really helpful. But for the most part, you know, my impulse to do that is, well, I'm not gonna make the music because that would not be good for anyone. And I don't know how, but also, you know, I'm interested in people that are pulling queer community together. So for me, it doesn't matter like the sort of status of the musician. It's just about like who queers kind of congregate around and who makes an attempt and has a commitment to bringing people together, because so much of my desire for my Scopatone remake, which I don't think I gave any images for this because it's like there's so much to talk about, but when I show the video work, I show them in these like installations that really provide space for leisure, but also like touching and you know, they'll have like couches and heart-shaped hot tubs and cozy fabrics and places to be intimate or dance. And so I think the musicians that I choose are also kind of creating spaces for those things also. So I think of them as like a little bit of like a moment for, you know, a peep show or a dance party.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's also so important to notice that you create these spaces where the videos are then shown. And the show at the MFA in Boston was very much like that. You walked in, yes. It's a hard tape tub, and then there was a, you know, projection of the videos, and then you had like little monitors that were behind the tin. The whole room was covered with tinsel,
little peep shows kind of emerging from the tinsel.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Peep show. And what about tinsel, actually?
Yeah, tinsel. Well, I love. Let me start with what I don't love. I don't love going into how do I say this? There are so many installations that I feel like so blown away to be in, but then the artist part of me goes like, this was, you know, $50,000 to make. This is so crazy. How do you make something like, you know? And I just really love the aesthetic of something that I've seen in like, you know, cheap kind of budget bat mitzvah parties and queer clubs or dive bars that want to have like a queer karaoke night, just throw up the tinsel. I mean, the tinsel, of course, now we see it in like bachelorette parties, you know, whatever. But like, for me, I acknowledge this history of it kind of just being in queer bars. And I'm Jewish, and I went to a lot of extravagant and budget bat mitzvahs and bar mitzvahs as a young person. And so like tinsel made an impact on me in that way. And I do want to say one thing, because I also identify the waste. There's a lot of materials being used. And so it's really important to me to reuse. I've been reusing the same tinsel for a really long time. And also when I have, like right now I have a installation opening in Utrecht, I have them like promise me that they find like a queer bar or like a teenage queer collective or something that will like have all the tinsel and use it for years. Cause I just, there are ways to reuse it. And I that's really important to me.
Yeah. Yeah. Which, as a side note, the other place other than the MFA Boston that I've seen this work installed was in my hometown in the Netherlands, which was completely random. My
so parents, cool. Yeah.
Random small town near Amsterdam, but not in Amsterdam. And Sam is like, I'm having a show in the Netherlands. I'm like, oh, where? Zaandam, 10 minutes from my house.
Yeah, that was amazing. That was very cool. And you and your mom were able to experience it, and I wasn't.
And so my mom went.
Yeah, that was really, really great. Yeah. Really great. Yeah. So you should, we should go to the Utrecht show that's opening in a few weeks.
Yes, I probably will not make it. I'm not traveling.
Not either.
Until October, if it's up in October.
It is. It's up for a really long time.
Yeah. Oh, really? Oh, I'll go see it. And you know that it's my mom's dream to be in your video, but she has to wait 7 more years to.
She's a little young. Yeah, she's a little young for
mom
me.
Is young.
I mean, I'm desperate to have your mom. Your mom is such a great performer. I've seen her performing lesbian songs to you. So
it's true. It's true. Sam, we are out of time. I feel like we could have a whole another like part two conversation just about the videos and film.
Let me say this. If you are just desperately in love with our chemistry, you are welcome to see us on the many videos of talking about Tori Amos that we did. So there's more of our beautiful chemistry. I mean, I'm kind of jokingly plugging that, but no, you and I have talked a lot on Zoom recording. So we always are really talkative.
Yes, we are very talkative. We talk on the phone a lot. And if you want to know more about this work immediately, then I did happen to review Sam's MFA Boston show for the Brooklyn Rail. What was that?
I don't remember when it came out, but the show was up from June to
October this June,
in 21. Yeah.
Exactly. So I think it's in the June 2021 issue, and it's a great review. Some famous self-promotion there. I think we can open it up to questions now.
Yeah, I just want to say that my show at Candice Mady is open for one more week. And it's like really important to me that enough, as many queers as possible, put their energy into that space, because I really, really like made that for the queer community. And it would be exciting for me to know that you're all going out there.
And I'm going to say that like 10 more times before we jump off.
Go for it.
All right. Eleanor, I'll hand it over to you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Samantha. And thank you, Ksenia. This has really been an amazing, amazing conversation. I'm so glad we got to see the videos. You guys have such great chemistry. It's been really fun. I'm so grateful that we could all be here. I do wanna just turn it over to the Q&A now.
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, we have a couple audience questions here. Our first question will be from Kobe Mules, if I'm saying that correctly. Kobe, if you feel comfortable, you can unmute, turn on your camera and unmute. Is Kobe here?
Kobe might have put it in the chat too.
Kobe, are you? I see Kobe's still here. Are you able to unmute, Kobe? If not, I can ask on your behalf. Okay, maybe I'll ask Kobe's question on their behalf for now. Kobe's question is, remaking seems to be important in both your painting and video, and I would be curious to hear about how that interest came about.
Sure, yeah. Okay, so I probably have an answer that I would have answered a few years ago, but a few months ago I was preparing for a talk and something hit me, and I realized exactly where this comes from, which is, as a kid, I was the type of child who would watch something over and over and over and over again, like on repeat, and just kind of till I just knew it all. And it was very annoying to everyone around. But my parents introduced me to The Wiz and The Wizard of Oz at the same time. And so we would do these viewings of The Wiz, The Wizard of Oz, The Wiz, The Wizard of Oz. And for any of you that know, you know, The Wizard of Oz and The Wiz, it's like, you can see, it's not shot by shot comparison, but it's this idea of like remaking something to represent something that the original is missing, and, you know, to make it like more fun, more inclusive, more exciting. And for me, I think that's like what I realize now is like a real root. Whereas I think before I thought of it more like an academic or like a logical strategy. Now I'm realizing, no, this like actually comes from something that's like kind of deep. And if you are ever interested in doing the Wizard of Oz comparison, I have to point you towards the Emerald City kind of scenes in both. You will not see a better scene than the Wiz when they get into the I want to be seen green. If you've seen it, you know what I'm saying. But if not, look for it. It's amazing.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Kobe, for that question. And thank you, Samantha. Our next question will be from Dominique Seneca. Dominique, you should be able to unmute and ask your question.
Hello, thank you for doing this talk and being here with us today. I'm really fascinated by your work, actually. I just finished my master's in museum studies at NYU. And my thesis was on the topic of showing sex and porn in museum spaces. And I was wondering, what really inspired you to celebrate pleasure in your artwork and feel empowered to do so?
Yeah. You know, I just like, I think I just was desperate to see it. I mean, you know, it's like maybe a little bit cliche to answer that way, like make the work that you want to see. But I really feel that. I was really desperate to see pleasure depicted in this way with these bodies and these people. I'm obsessed with your makeup and your nails, by the way. You look beautiful. and so I really wanted to see it. And I think that I can say that because you said you were specifically interested within the museum, right? So that's a really recent thing for me. I mean, my show at the Museum of Fine Arts Boston was really the first time I had the experience of kind of engaging with an institution that way, which was absolutely fascinating. And I had such an incredible curator that kind of like pulled me through any of the hoops. Because there was a lot kind of pushing against such overt portrayals of sexuality and non-binary bodies was like a big one. And they wanted, you know, the institution requested a sign to talk about the types of nudity. And my curator was so beautiful in like navigating like their request, but also like putting it back at them and like shining, like, well, every single room in this museum has you know, cis women that are fully naked. So why are you requesting this here? Let me use language that reminds you of that rather than actually giving like a warning. I think that, something Ksenia said earlier and your question, because I am new to showing in the museum, is reminding me, like, I mean, I was making this work for a really long time where nobody was showing it. It wasn't really being shown in anywhere, galleries, museums, any context. So I guess what made me want to make it was just that I wanted to make the work, and now I feel lucky enough to actually be showing it. Yeah, I hope that answers. Awesome.
That was a great question. And I think the curator is Michelle Fisher, and I think that the phrasing was, it was something like, this installation includes images of sex, da-da-da-da-da-da, and then it said something like, these are all common themes in art history, right? Mm-hmm. And I thought that was so brilliant.
Yeah, it was like, if you're gonna check yourself needing a warning, like, you have to realize that you haven't had a warning in this entire, yeah. And then someone told me that was the first time like the term non-binary bodies was in the museum, in that museum at least. And that was crazy to me, but it, you know, exciting.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Dominique. That was awesome. I think Sophia, do you have a question? Sophia Poirier?
Hi, yeah. I'm unmuted. Yeah, okay.
I know you.
So we saw Tori invoked in the daddy video with a Tori wig. I wondered if there are ever Tori references in the paintings.
Oh, I love you. You know, this was a deep inquiry that Ksenia started when we started this Tori project. I didn't realize that was true, but I think it's true. I definitely have some redheads for sure. And when painting a redhead, of course, I'm thinking Tori. But also, you know, what I learned through this project, for those of you that don't know, we did a project on dykes and Toriemos and investigating my work and another artist, Kata, our work and how it refers to our love of Tori. And I think what we both learned was that Tori created this at a young age for us when we became Toriemos fans. Tori created this love and this like understanding of the way that sexuality and family play. And so I think that understanding the aging process, and for Kata, the process of like youth and coming into like a sexual identity from the opposite end of the age spectrum, that like Tori's kind of wrapped up in so much of both of our understandings on like identity and sexuality and aging. So yeah, I do think she's there somewhere. I love that you brought up Tori, because like what Zoom video of mine wouldn't be complete without Tori.
And also, I actually mentioned this in my last Broken Real Talk, but this is a better occasion to say that you and I met Tori.
We did.
Last week or 2 weeks ago now. And we gave her the book that we did.
Yeah. Yeah, and then she asked me where my show was, and I could hardly speak.
She could not speak.
I could easily tell you right now that my show is in the Lower East Side at Candace Mady Gallery, but when Tori Amos asked me where my show was, I could hardly say those words. She asked me to say it twice, and I was like, God, I got through it one time. How do I say it again?
Yes. So just to mention it again, Sam's show is at 1 Rivington, Candace Mady Gallery. Candace Mady. I don't think I've ever asked Candace how to pronounce her last name. I always say Mady, but maybe it's Maddie.
Maybe. Well, listen, Candace can tell us. But all I'm saying, as long as Tori Amos is not on this call, I can tell you that it is at the Candace Mega Gallery in the Lower East Side.
Unless anyone has other questions, I actually realized that, I mean, there's Tori, but also another thing that's so important in your work as a reference that I didn't know about until we met and you had a birthday party themed to this is the Golden Girls.
I'm here right now.
Which probably nobody else is surprised. And I was like, what is the Golden Girls?
She Googled the Golden Girls.
I Googled the Golden Girls. But I also, my then partner is American. And I mean, no, I guess she did know what the, but she also, she's not, you know, she wasn't helpful.
She wasn't helpful. I'm sorry for that. You guys both have homework. Well, anyway, I'm coming to you from the Golden Girls living room. I love the Golden Girls. I can go on and on, but I love the Golden Girls. I start, whenever I'm like asked to do an artist talk in like university or whatever, I start off with two things. I start off with a clip of the Golden Girls, one of their various like lesbian specific clips. And then I do a montage of music videos because I think MTV from the 80s and 90s and the Golden Girls are like my main aesthetic references. So this is, I teach, and so I don't really want my students when I'm teaching Zoom to see my house. So this is where I always come to them from. Nobody knows. They don't know what this reference is.
Thank you so much. We do have another question from Juno. Juno, you should be able to unmute. Want to ask?
Yeah. Hey, everybody. Hey, Samantha, Mike, Philly to Philly. My question is about just responses that you've received from over 50 dykes. Have you received responses from more random people, people who maybe didn't know your work before? And if so, what have they been?
Sure. Okay. How honest do I get here? Okay, so there have been, I mean, I truly like don't have such a, I haven't had the experience of like really, a lot of people that I've engaged with have not been over 50 dykes, unfortunately. It's like my dream come true to have more. I've had an interesting experience with painter dykes that are painters, you know, over 50, who may have come up against a lot of like homophobia, misogyny in their own painting careers. And so something like my work being as figurative as it is or as overtly sexual as it is, sometimes actually feels really intimidating to or off-putting. I don't know what the word would be, but you know, I think there's a lot that lesbian painters of that age have overcome in their own life. So I've had people, well, I won't name them, but I've had, you know, lesbian painters walk into the room and be like, whoa, I don't want to go to this party. This is too much for me. I can't, this is like, I am uncomfortable. This is too sexual. I can't come to this party. And I'm like, that's okay. You don't have to be invited. There's also a room in the back. You don't know what's going on in there. Maybe they're just watching TV. Like, it's fine. But I have had a couple people write to me and tell me that it was really important and special for them to see. But my dream would be to be in a room full of like, you know, elder lesbians hearing what it feels like to see the work. It just hasn't happened yet.
You're like, there's a room in the back that's abstract.
Yes, there's an abstract room. There's a room that's just full of abstraction and it's cozy and there's chairs and everyone's wearing clothes. I hope that answered your question. I feel like I wish I had a really exciting answer for you, but something that's come up for me a lot that I didn't expect at all are, you know, dykes in their 40s, 30s, 20s, kind of like thanking me for the work, for creating like a space for the future, which is exactly what I'm trying to do in the work, is like think about my own future and what I want to see. But I didn't really think about like being thanked, which felt really awkward at first, but like delightful. And then I realized like, okay, I get it. Like there's a thing that we kind of wish long for, you know? And that's the experience I've had more often.
Interesting. No, thank you for that answer. Really interesting. I mean, I'm 59. I absolutely loved it. It was incredibly, I mean, if I follow you, you know, and I've seen the work online, but of course, but to see it in person was incredibly empowering, to use a very overused word. But it was, and to see women who are my age and much older, all shapes and sizes, was absolutely incredible. And it gives permission. It gives permission to look, it gives permission to be, it, you know, all those kind of big things. So thank you so much for.
I love hearing that. Thank you for sharing that so much. That really means a lot. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And I know you're in Philly, you just said, right? And yes. I feel like we've communicated on Instagram.
We have, because I went to see the show just a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
And posted. Okay.
We're going to have to connect in Philly.
Definitely. DykeArthouse.org. There you go.
Amazing. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Juno. That was a really great question. I would love to ask, I have a question that I would actually love to ask you, Samantha.
Yeah, please.
I was just wondering if you could kind of expand on the way you depict gender in paintings and like just kind of talk more about your primary focus on feminine bodies, or maybe how that is connecting, like that connects to anything related to you as an artist or a person or your own gender experience.
Yeah. I mean, I'm interested in kind of like what I have seen as like a sort of queer lesbian identified gender, which is kind of all over. I mean, there's really a myth. I had a studio assistant for a second who was probably, they were in their 20s, and they were really convinced that lesbian identity has never included a gender spectrum of non-binary bodies, trans bodies. And it was really painful for me to hear, because that isn't, has never been the experience of the lesbian community that I've known. And particularly of all ages. When I was young, I was super lucky to be offered a barn to rent from my massage school teacher. And it was, the language wasn't there yet, but what it would be called now would be like a trans inclusive lesbian separatist space. And I think now the term lesbian is often connected really painfully to the term TERF. And I feel that has not been my experience, and I feel like really rebelling against that. And so when depicting the bodies in my paintings, I'm really clear that lesbian identity encompasses all gender expression. And it's really important to me that this space, if I'm making a utopic experience, I am not going to just like prioritize like cis lesbian bodies. It's never been the true lesbian kind of experience that I've seen modeled. And I think that's like a real focus. Does that answer the question? I feel like there's probably more in there, but that's like my first impulse.
Yeah, and I mean, you're preaching in this case to the choir, and I wouldn't say that there is a focus on feminine bodies in your work. In fact, I think that
I think that's right.
There is a range. You know, there are non-binary bodies, and I just put it in the chat, but yeah, I always say that lesbian comes in many genders. My research is focuses around lesbian identity.
And I'm really interested in like people identifying as butch. I have like, you know, trans femmes and trans exactly. Like all kinds of people in there. And, you know, I'm finding them through various internet searches. I'm kind of, once I'm finding the people for the paintings, I'm just kind of painting them as I see them, or an expression of how I see them.
Yeah. And I think important to note is that, you know, just because the contemporary language wasn't there doesn't mean that the identity wasn't there.
Absolutely. It's so important. I remember
perception nowadays.
What I realized now is I didn't finish the story about my studio assistant, which is we went and did some research at the Lesbian History Archives, and they left being like, oh fuck, wow. Cause we just looked at like kink magazines from the 70s, and I remember seeing their face, and I was like, tell your friends. This is not like this idea that you have about lesbian identity, like with a little research could actually be beautifully reworded. But yeah, that's a good question. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I feel like your answer kind of was the phrase that I was looking for in my question. So that we
yeah, thank you so much.
I think that we are going to be turning now to our closing poet.
Yeah, that's exciting.
I'm so excited here to have to introduce our poet laureate of the day, Dia Felix. Dia is an experimental writer and producer living in New York. She wrote the Lambda-nominated experimental novel, No Cheetah, in 2014 from City Lights / Sister Spit, the love-drunk poetry chapbook, You, 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 and the LA fabulous short fiction, A Star is Drunk. By day, she is a media producer with a focus on artists and artworks. Thank you for joining us, Dia, and I'm so happy to turn the mic over to you.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Okay. This is so exciting. I so loved that conversation. Samantha, I have just discovered you, so I'm so excited to learn more about you and your work. And I feel like I have so much exciting stuff to think about. And so thank you for the conversation, and thank you, Brooklyn Rail, also for inviting me to do this. I'm just going to read just a couple of poems, which I sort of pulled out of my like poem drawer, but which I think sort of, they're sort of resonant, I hope, with, you know, the way your work makes me feel, which is romantic and embodied and fantastical and utopic. So this one is called Bum Vivant. In my new leopard print loungewear taking my breakfast, I woke up babbling, miracle, miracle. But how can you back up into a cloud? Cloud fingers to embrace me now. I do rest backwards on the cloud of cloud breath. Yes, youth, you made me spring a dick from the middle of my freaky meadow. Yes, youth, I do want to park my full face into your epicenter, basting and brining all night until my face is inside your middle, locked, and together we make an American dragon. God, are you gay again for the youth? Yes, youth, I want to put a thumb in your plum and simultaneously arrest your scallop. Do you think I could write a recipe book of your interpretation of the yogic sciences? Can I interest you in being my alphabet? Please do. Powder my tender hunger. Would you tend to the nightly removal of my silicone eye? They sometimes sleep talk in their brine. Just imagine working this into our vows. The mouthless horde all would take a knee at our overwhelming wit. My heart, a hungry ghost? No, a libidinous Pac-Man, born only to blink, consume, seize with the perfect crush of too many flavors. God is great. The body itself, wait. Is a fracture towards healing? Listen, I am making at least as much sense as a certain critic here, signaling with my brain droppings. You know what I mean, right? Where's my whatever award? This poem is called Fairfax. I'm really like, speaking of like Hockney and LA dreams, but from like away, like LA dreams that are not like situated in LA or native to LA. And like I really get off on like LA street names. Like I just like to roll around and be like La Cienega, Vine, Fairfax. So that there's a lot of LA weird, like, I don't know, eroticism in my work that was just based on mouthfeel. Okay, Fairfax. A plate of nachos suckling my tender nipples as I too consume a plate of nachos slowly on a curb whilst think of it. Flowers drunk on themselves administer gentle enemas to their neighbor flowers and all get so heavy they bob together like opium co-lovers. It's so layered. We, co-sleeper, while your clit in your pants also grows roots into a cloud of grease atop queso fundido on your ghost beans. Your spices fall like angel dust from humid glass jars. Let's make mini martinis and drink them in our dollhouse. Weirdly, light radiates from the core of the house. Weirdly, I've never gotten an electricity bill. If your house is glowing and you pay no bills, you're either in the afterlife or you're dreaming. You started to dream of parking lots, of plastic shopping carts as big as SUVs, of rabbits as large as Labradors. Things get out of scale when you look at the water too long. A leaf floating in water is talking to me. What's it say? What I am, you will be. This poem is called Vulva Tone. A heart that eats iPhones, a total love, heart with teeth, hungry heart, a white infant that also produces gold coins, a baby born with gold chains, a baby born with face tattoos, a flower blooming while angry, an irate fish, a rat in ecstasy fumbling with a wad of cheese, a woman waking to a bedside creamed whiskey. In ecstasy now, I suck the tit of morning, honey tapped. I'm a rap hit hummingbird. I stimulate the airwaves with my little finger moves. The rat in ecstasy though, nibbling through my dreams, the rat follows you like a metaphor to the dream salon where the sister version of you chats comfortably with others. If you are not a poet, if you are not an alien, if you are not a rat canoodler, what would you be? In the sad showgirls union hall, we hang our pretty heads together and imagine that we are in another country watching Varda films and being better and more alive versions of ourselves. Is this any way to live? A rat exhales. Okay, I'm gonna share one more with you that's quite short. And I'll just say now, again, just thanks for listening. And again, I'm Dia Felix. If you wanna get in touch with me about anything, I welcome any comments or communications or connections. Okay, this is called Grab Bag. Artist statements that sell. You have a lot to learn about abstraction. I like to cry in private, so I know I'm not doing it for my brand. I need your products for my sexuality. Free the police. A fucking butterfly. You jerk. Off knives. You have no right to reggae. The stakes really are myself, though. Thank you all again.
Incredible. Thank you so much, Dia. And of course, thank you so much again, Samantha and Ksenia. Thank you to all of our audience members here today. And thank you, Bella and the extended Canvas Media team for helping make today's event possible. Over the past 22 years, the Brooklyn Whirl has brought together art, music, dance, film, theater, literature, and thoughtful political and social meditations in our publication and our public events, like here in our daily NSE. Please check the chat for a link to donate to support our writers, editors, and operations here at the Rail. And please join us tomorrow at 1 p.m. for our 87th Radical Poetry Reading with Holly Melgard, featuring poetry read by Diana Hamilton, Liz Howard, Sid Spati, Chris Sylvester, and Holly Melgard. You can now turn on your mics and say hello and goodbye as you leave. I'm so grateful to have been here today. Cool. With all of you. Say,
thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
I want to publicly thank you.
Hi, Anna.
Thank you, you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you, bye, everyone.
Thank you, Dia. Oh my God, those poems were so amazing.
Yes, definitely.
Thank you, Ksenia.
Hi, Fong. Let's see.
And we encourage everyone to go see the show.
Yes, go see the show. Oh, I said I would say 10
more times. Go see the show.
Yeah, go see the show.
One Remington. You have to go. One stairs up.
Congratulations, you guys.
Thank you so much. Thank you for inviting me.
can't wait to see the show, and thanks for the reading. It's very inspiring. We are working away here and very excited. Once we put the issue to bed, which is tomorrow, I'm free to come and see the show. Yes. Hooray.
Excellent. I'm so honored to have been asked to do this. Thank you so much.
Oh, it's our honor. Pleasure, really. Congrats. And yeah, keep up the good work. Much love and courage, you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.